Hello students, in this lesson we shall see about obsessive compulsive disorder and phobias. We shall start with obsessive compulsive disorder, also known as OCD. So what is this OCD or obsessive compulsive disorder? Obsessive compulsive disorder is a mental disorder which is characterized by the presence of obsessions and or compulsions. The DSM-5, that is Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, 5th edition, has listed 9 disorders under obsessive compulsive and related disorders. These include obsessive compulsive disorder, body dysmorphic disorder, hoarding disorder, trichotillomania disorder, that is hair pulling disorder, excoriation disorder, that is skin picking disorder, other specified obsessive compulsive and related disorder, and unspecified obsessive compulsive and related disorder. Example, body focused repetitive behavior disorder, obsessional jealousy, etc. Now, the ICD-10, that is International Classification of Diseases, 10th edition, has listed 5 disorders related to OCD under the neurotic, stress related and somatoform disorders, which ranges, the coding ranges from F40 to F48, where F42 is devoted to obsessive compulsive disorder. And the disorders that fall under this category are predominantly obsessional thoughts or ruminations, predominantly compulsive acts, mixed obsessional thoughts and acts, other obsessive compulsive disorders, obsessive compulsive disorder unspecified. Now, I would like to direct your attention to the screen to view the diagnostic criteria of obsessive compulsive disorder. We've spoken about obsessions and compulsions. So let's see what are these obsessions and compulsions. So obsessions can be defined as recurrent and persistent thoughts, urges or images that are experienced as intrusive and unwanted, which are disturbing, inappropriate and uncontrollable. Now, what are these compulsions? Compulsions are the repetitive behaviors or mental acts that an individual feels driven to perform in response to the obsessions, to avoid some dreadful situation or must do so. This only happens when they try to avoid a particular dreadful situation or when they want to avoid some kind of anxiety that they feel. I'm sure most of us must have experienced minor obsessive thoughts, such as whether we've locked the door or not, whether we've turned the stove off or not, or whether we've switched off the lights or left them on. So these behaviors and subsequently also the checking behaviors are common. However, with OCD, these obsessions and repetitive behaviors are much more persistent and distressing, which profusely interfere with everyday activities, making the person's life worse. As we've been talking about these obsessions, what do they include of? Many obsessive thoughts involve contamination fears, fears of harming oneself or others, and pathological doubt. Other obsessions fairly include themes of concern or need for symmetry, or sexual obsessions and obsessions concerning religion, violence or aggression. Now let us see what are these compulsive behaviors that are performed so ritualistically by these persons with OCD. These rituals can be of two types, that is the compulsive behaviors. Firstly, washing or cleaning rituals. They can range from mild to extreme. That is, mild would be spending up to 15 to 20 minutes washing one's hands after going to the bathroom. And also, the extreme case involves washing hands with disinfectants until the point that the hand starts to bleed. Now, secondly, checking rituals, which can range from mild to severe as well, such as checking all the lights, appliances and locks 2 or 3 times before leaving the house, to going back to a place where the person with OCD imagines that he or she accidentally has killed or harmed a person. So they go back and they check this imagined situation altogether. So this is the extreme form of the checking ritual. The performance of these compulsive acts brings a feeling of reduced tension and satisfaction, as well as a sense of control. Although this anxiety relief is very fleeting and the individual is stuck in these cycles of obsessive thoughts and compulsive behaviors. Thus, we know that obsessive compulsive disorder is one of the most disabling mental disorder, which leads to lower quality of life and a great deal of functional impairment, and it co-occurs with mood disorders, anxiety disorders, and in some cases with social phobia, panic disorder, generalized anxiety disorder, and also with post-traumatic stress disorder. Now, let's look at the causal factors of obsessive compulsive disorder. Twin studies reveal that monozygotic twins are slightly at a higher risk of developing OCD when compared to the dizygotic twins. Moreover, research also suggests that OCD begins in the childhood and is usually characterized by chronic motor tics and is later manifested into a full-blown obsessive-compulsive disorder. Neurological basis of OCD, that is, abnormalities in the basal ganglia and the amygdala, which control the emotions and emotional behavior, can lead to OCD. Neurotransmitter abnormalities also suggest that increased serotonin activity and increased sensitivity of some brain structures to serotonin are involved in the OCD symptoms. Now, coming to the psychological causal factors. Mohrer's two-process theory of avoidance learning explains OCD, stating that the neutral stimuli becomes associated with frightening thoughts or experiences through classical conditioning and elicits anxiety. For instance, let's look at an example. When touching a doorknob or shaking hands with somebody is associated with the scary idea of contamination, and this association is made, the person may discover that the anxiety produced by shaking hands or touching a doorknob can be reduced by washing hands. Washing his or hands extensively reduces the anxiety, and so this washing response is reinforced, which makes it more likely to occur again and again in the future, and also in different situations where the person feels the fear of contamination. Once learned, such avoidance responses are extremely resistant to extinction. Now let's look at the cognitive causal factors. If we observe, when we try to suppress some unwanted thoughts, we do experience a paradoxical increase in those thoughts. This happens in our day-to-day life as well. But the difference between the people with normal and abnormal obsessions is primarily the degree to which they resist their own thoughts and find them unacceptable. Thus, when people with OCD attempt to suppress these thoughts, this could contribute to the frequency of obsessive thoughts and the negative moods with which they are often associated. People with OCD often seem to have an inflated sense of responsibility, and in turn, in some vulnerable people, this inflated sense of responsibility can be associated with beliefs that simply having a thought of doing something, that is, suppose a person has a thought of, say, attacking his or her mother. So this thought, it's just a thought. But for these people who have an inflated sense of responsibility, it is morally equivalent to actually having been done that thought. So this is called thought-action fusion. And it is these thoughts that also force the person to perform the compulsive behaviors to reduce or stop the consequences from happening. A behavioral treatment that combines exposure and response prevention has been proved effective to treat obsessive compulsive disorder. In this treatment, clients with OCD develop a hierarchy of upsetting stimuli and rate them on a scale, on a rating scale of 0 to 100 according to the stimuli's capacity to evoke anxiety, distress, or disgust. Then the clients are asked to expose themselves repeatedly, either through guided fantasy or directly, to the stimuli that provokes their obsession. Following each exposure, they are asked not to engage in the rituals that they ordinarily would engage in to reduce the anxiety or distress provoked by these obsessional thoughts. Preventing the rituals is essential so that they can see that if they allow enough time to pass, the anxiety created by the obsession would come down naturally to at least 40 to 50 points on a 100-point scale. And in addition to the exposures conducted during the therapy sessions, homework is also assigned to the clients. Some people refuse such treatment or even drop out early, but if one continues, it does help up to 50 to 70% of the symptoms to be reduced, and the patient would have an improved quality of life eventually. Also, medications till date have affected the neurotransmitter serotonin, which seems to be the primary class of medication to treat persons with OCD. But a major disadvantage of medication treatment for OCD, as for other anxiety disorders, is that when the medication is discontinued, relapse rates are generally very high. Now, for the second part of the lesson, we shall learn about different types of phobias. We shall learn about specific phobia, agoraphobia, and thirdly, social phobia, now known as social anxiety disorder. So first, let's learn about specific phobia. So the DSM-5, as we've already seen, Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, 5th edition, has listed specific phobia under anxiety disorders, and the diagnosis needs to be specified if it is phobia towards animals, natural environment, blood injection injury, situational, or others. The ICD-10 International Classification of Diseases, 10th edition, has listed specific isolated phobias under neurotic stress-related and somatoform disorders. Coding ranges from F40 to F48, where F40 is denoted to phobic anxiety disorder. And the code for specific isolated phobia is F40.2. Now, I would like to direct your attention again to the screen to view the diagnostic criteria for specific phobia. Let's look at the clinical picture of specific phobias. A person is diagnosed as having a specific phobia if they show strong and persistent fear toward that particular object or situation. It is important to know that when individuals with specific phobias encounter a phobic stimulus, they often show an immediate fear response that often resembles a panic attack, except for the existence of a clear external trigger. The DSM-5 has recognized 5 subtypes of specific phobias. They are animal type, which includes fear of snakes, spiders, dogs, insects, birds, etc. Natural environment type, which includes storms, heights, water. That is, the fear of storms, heights, water, and likewise. Then blood injection injury type. Fear of seeing blood or an injury. Receiving an injection, seeing a person in a wheelchair. Situational type includes phobias of public transportation, tunnels, bridges, elevators, flying, driving, or enclosed spaces. Others are fear of choking, vomiting, and space phobia is where fear of falling down if away from walls or any support is also another type. The fear or anxiety that people with specific phobia experience when they encounter a phobic stimuli, an object or situation, may range from mild feelings of apprehension and distress, usually while still at some distance, to full-fledged activation of fight or flight response. Regardless of its intensity, phobic behavior tends to be reinforced because every time the person with a phobia avoids a feared situation, his or her anxiety decreases. Also, the secondary benefits of being disabled are increased attention, sympathy, and some control over the behavior of others may also reinforce such phobias. And the time of onset of these different types of different phobias, according to the age, gender, and ethnicity of an individual, differ. While some tend to begin early in life, some begin late. Etiology of specific phobias, that is, the causal factors of these specific phobias. The psychoanalytical view suggests that phobias represent a defense against anxiety that stems from repressed impulses of the id. According to Freud, repressed impulses of the id, which are not to be known, the anxiety is displaced onto some other external object or situation that has some symbolic relationship to the real object of the anxiety. However, this theory has its vast number of speculations as well. Some behaviorists state that phobias are learnt behaviors. Phobic behavior is learnt through classical conditioning, where the fear response is conditioned to previously neutral stimuli when these stimuli are paired with traumatic or painful events. Also, once acquired, phobic fear would be generalized to others, similar objects or situations. Try and remember the experiment of Little Albert. That would explain the generalization better. Vicarious conditioning. Direct traumatic conditioning, as we have seen, is not the only way that people can learn irrational phobic fears from. Simply watching a person or a person who has a phobia or a fear towards a particular object or a situation can be distressing to the observer and can result in fear being transferred from one person to another person through vicarious or observational classical conditioning. However, watching a non-fearful person undergoing a frightening experience can also lead to a vicarious conditioning. The evolutionary preparedness for learning certain fears and phobias. Primates and humans seem to be evolutionarily prepared to rapidly associate certain objects such as snakes, spiders, water, and enclosed spaces with frightening or unpleasant events which we might have carried forward through evolution. A form of behavioral therapy called exposure therapy, which is the best treatment for specific phobias, is available. It involves controlled exposure to the stimuli or situations that elicit phobic fear, and these clients are gradually placed in symbolic situations or real-life conditions. In these situations that frighten them, and are encouraged to expose themselves either alone or with the help of the therapist or a friend for long periods of time till their fear begins to subside. For certain phobias such as small animal phobias, flying phobia, claustrophobia, and blood injury phobia, exposure therapy is often highly effective when administered in a single long session of up to 3 hours. Another variant of this procedure is known as participant modeling, has also been proved to be effective, where the therapist himself or herself models the particular kind of behavior or the adaptive and proper coping behavior for these phobias and shows it to the client, and the client tries to imitate those behaviors. A combination of cognitive reconstructing techniques or medications with exposure-based techniques has also been tried. But the addition or the sole use of any of these therapeutic or medical techniques did not have any better effect or result when compared to the effectiveness of exposure-based techniques alone. The term agoraphobia is taken from a Greek word meaning agora, which means marketplace. People with agoraphobia are afraid of being in public places or situations where escape might seem difficult or help is unavailable should they experience panic or become incapacitated. The DSM-5 lists agoraphobia under anxiety disorders, and the ICD-10 lists agoraphobia under the same neurotic, stress-related and somatoform disorders, where the coding ranges from F40 to F48, and this is subcategorized under phobic anxiety disorder. The code is F40, and under which there is a separate code for agoraphobia, where it is classified into agoraphobia without panic disorder and agoraphobia with panic disorder, with the codes 0.00 and 0.01 respectively. Likewise, DSM-5 has also changed its former classification of agoraphobia as a subtype of panic disorder. It was mentioned in DSM-4TR that way, but it has separated and recognized it as a different separate disorder in DSM-5. As we have already seen that people with agoraphobia are afraid of being in public places where they fear they cannot get any help in case of any emergency, this fear leads them to avoid situations, including going out into streets, crowded places, etc. Many people with agoraphobia are virtually unable to leave their house, and even those who do leave their house do so with great difficulty and distress. Now, we shall look at the screen to view the diagnostic criteria of agoraphobia. Now, let's look at the treatment procedures for agoraphobia. Research shows that through years, there has been little impact made in the treatment of agoraphobia, that is the fear of leaving one's home and entering public spaces. However, more recently, new approaches developed by behaviorists, that is a variety of exposure approaches for agoraphobia, have been beneficial. In these interventions, therapists typically help clients to venture farther and farther away from their homes to gradually enter an outside place one step at a time. This is done gradually. Sometimes the therapists use support, reasoning, and coaxing to get clients to confront the outside world. They also use more systematic exposure methods. Exposure therapy for people with agoraphobia often includes additional features, particularly the use of support groups and home-based self-help programs to motivate clients to work hard at their treatment. In the support group approach, a small number of people with agoraphobia go out together for exposure sessions that last for up to several hours, and the group members support each other and encourage each other and eventually coax one another to move away from safety of the group and perform exposure tasks on their own. In the home-based self-help programs, clinicians give clients and their families detailed instructions for carrying out exposure treatments themselves. Unfortunately, the improvements are often partial rather than complete due to the major problem of relapses in this disorder. Social phobia or social anxiety disorder is characterized by disabling fears of one or more specific social situations, such as public speaking, urinating in public bathrooms, or eating or writing in public. The DSM-5 lists social anxiety disorder under anxiety disorders, and the diagnosis needs to be specified if it is performance only. The ICD-10 lists social phobia under the neurotic, stress-related, and somatoform disorders, and subcategorizes them under phobic anxiety disorders, under which social phobia bears the code of F40.1. Although this disorder is labeled social phobia in DSM-40R, the term social anxiety disorder was proposed in the DSM-5 because the problems caused by it tend to be much more pervasive and interfere much more with normal activities than the problems caused by other phobias. In these situations, a person fears that he or she may be exposed to a scrutiny and potential negative evaluation of others, or that he or she may act in an embarrassing or humiliating manner before others. Because of these fears, people with social phobia either avoid these situations or endure them with great distress. Intense fear of public speaking is the single most common type of social phobia. DSM-5 also identifies two subtypes of social phobia. Firstly, the fear of performance situations such as public speaking, and secondly, that which is more general and includes non-performance situations such as eating or writing in public or performing any activity in public. Indeed, the people with the more general subtype of social phobia are the ones affected badly. Now, let's look at the screen to view the diagnostic criteria for social phobia or social anxiety disorder. Causes social anxiety disorder. Cognitive theorists and researchers contend that people with this disorder hold a group of social beliefs and expectations that consistently work against them. I shall list some of these beliefs: holding unrealistic high social standards and beliefs that they must perform perfectly in social situations, viewing themselves as unattractive social beings, and viewing themselves as socially unskilled and inadequate people. They believe that they are always in danger of behaving incompetently in social situations. They also believe that their inept behaviors in social situations will inevitably lead them to terrible consequences. They also believe that they have no control over feelings of anxiety that emerge in social situations. Beset by such beliefs and expectations, people with social anxiety disorder find that their anxiety levels increase as soon as they enter into a social situation. Later, after the social event has been completed, the individual repeatedly reviews the details of the event. They overestimate how poorly things went and how poorly they have done, what negative results may take place, thus reinforcing their fears. This suggests why they repeatedly perform avoidance and safety behaviors to help prevent or reduce such disasters. As we have seen earlier in our session where we discussed about OCD, where we learned that OCD can also co-occur with social anxiety disorder, is where these avoidance and safety behaviors are followed by the individuals, which becomes a cycle sort of, or a pattern sort of thing, leading them to have these obsessive compulsive thoughts. Some of the other causal factors for this disorder were identified to be biological factors such as genetic predisposition, trait tendencies, biological abnormalities, traumatic childhood experiences, and overprotective parent-child interactions during childhood. Now let's look at the treatments for social anxiety disorder. Over the years, therapists understood that social anxiety disorder or social phobia has two distinct features. That is, the first one, sufferers have overwhelming irrational social fears, and the second one, they often lack skill at starting conversations, communicating their needs, or meeting the needs of others. This insight has helped clinicians treat social anxiety by trying to reduce social fears by providing training in social skills. Another behavioral intervention is exposure therapy. Exposure therapists encourage clients with social fears to expose themselves to dreadful or dreaded social situations and to remain until their fears subside. So they are made to remain in such situations which evoke their fear until the fear of this individual subsides. Usually the exposure is gradual and it often includes homework assignments that are carried out in social situations. In addition, group therapy offers great help by allowing people to face fearful situations, that is fearful social situations, in an atmosphere of support and care. A combination of several behavioral techniques is the social skills training. Now we shall see what the social skills training involves. Here, the therapist usually models appropriate social behaviors to the clients and encourages them to try them out too. The client then role plays with the therapist, rehearsing these new behaviors until they become more effective. Throughout the process, therapists provide frank feedback and reinforcement, that is, praise, to the clients for effective performances. Reinforcement from other people with similar social difficulties is often more powerful than reinforcement from the therapist alone. In social skills training groups and assertiveness training groups, members try out and rehearse new social behaviors with other group members. Research suggests that social skills training, both individual and group formats, have helped many people perform better in social situations. Yet another cognitive therapy, such as the Albert Ellis REBT, Rational Emotive Behavioral Therapy, as we popularly call it, has also yielded good results, but usually when it is used in combination with behavioral techniques. So students, we have seen in this lesson about obsessive compulsive disorder, the diagnostic criteria, the clinical picture of obsessive compulsive disorder, and the etiology and treatment of obsessive compulsive disorder. And we have seen, as the second part of the lesson, three different types of phobias, that is specific phobia, agoraphobia, and thirdly, social phobia, now called as social anxiety disorder. So we have seen the symptomatology, etiology, that is the causes and treatments for these three disorders as well. Thank you.